Game might as well be huge databases, because there's just so much data inside a single game. And I'm not talking about stuff like 3D models or sounds or animation, I'm talking about all the metadata, like weapon damage, weapon range, accuracy, character perks, strength, agility, dexterity, inventory size, wheel radius, friction, item names, item design. Hi everyone, welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus, a solo game developer, currently working on my own project called Solar Rogue. And if you're wondering what's on my shoulder, then I'm recording this on the 25th of May, so just Google it and you'll understand. Now, to get down to business, I want to talk this week about game data and how you organize it in your code. Throughout my years of experience, I've seen many different ways of storing metadata for your game, and I've tried to break them down in four different categories. Number one, put everything inside your code. It might seem obvious, but it's actually a valid way of doing things. First of all, if you put everything into structures or classes or defines, then all your accesses are going to be very, very fast, and you're going to avoid potential typo, because if you misspell, for example, a define, then your game is just not going to compile. On the minus side, it also means that every time you change your data, you're going to have to recompile your whole game, and it means things are not going to be very flexible for you. Number two is the second most easy way of doing things, I think, is just putting everything into text file. It doesn't matter if it's your own custom format, an .ini file format, or CSV, or JSON, or XML, just put it into plain text. The plus side of this is that it's really easy to make changes, and you can even do sweeping changes by just inputting some fancy regular expression into your favorite text editor. The minus side is that once your database starts being huge, loading all this JSON and doing all the parsing and converting all of those strings into text or numbers is going to start taking quite a lot of time, and it can become a bit of a mess. Number three, use the editor that comes with your favorite game engine. This has a few advantages and inconveniences. First of all, if everything is built into the engine, then it means it's very easy to tweak and to adjust and to work with it. And you can probably even change things on the fly while the game is running to really do some quick iteration when you're trying to balance something. On the minus side, you're very limited to whatever the engine is going to give to you. That means that some data type might not be easy to expose to the editor. For example, Godot doesn't support setting typed arrays, so you can't say to Godot that you want to expose an array of int. Sometimes it can also be difficult to do sweeping changes. For example, if you have like 500 prefab of enemies and you decide that you need to add a component into all of those enemies, it's gonna take a long time in Unity to open all of those prefab and add one component at a time in each of those. Where if you had a text file, then maybe you could have done like a quick Python script to update all the text file at once, or you could have done a vim command with some regex and process it on all the files. It could have been much easier. So finally, this brings us to number four, using external tools. And this is actually split into two subcategories, using your own built custom tools or using someone else's custom tools. Now, there's different advantages and convenience with all of those. If you're making your own tools, well, you're probably going to be using one of the three previous methods, and then you're just going to create some kind of interface to view and parse and modify your data. This adds a lot of flexibility and ease of use to your data because you choose how you display it. You can even integrate some kind of logic inside your metadata, for example, some kind of inheritance or something that you can display in your own personal tools. On the minus side, it means you have to support a whole program that will probably never be used by anyone else. Now, if you go with an external tool, like, for example, one of the nice tricks I've seen is using Excel spreadsheets to put your game data in and then reading that from your game. Well, now you have access to incredibly fancy and advanced features like, you know, Excel's formula parser, scripting language, pivot tables, or if you're using MySQL, then you have all the power of SQL queries at your fingertips. And if you're familiar with those techniques, then this is going to save you incredibly a lot of time. Now, the disadvantage with this technique is that if you're using an external tool, then you're very dependent on whatever updates or whatever API library you're using. So for example, if Excel decides to change their file format, which has happened to me in the past, then it's possible that all your game data is going to suddenly be completely corrupted and never work again on your game. So that's something to keep in mind. The method you choose is going to be very dependent on a lot of different factors. For example, the team size is going to be very important if you're planning to go with a binary file format, because you're going to run into issues with version control. Also, if your teammates think that regular expressions are a type of drink, then you probably want to keep them away from a Vim terminal. If you're planning to spend incredibly a lot of time tweaking each values in your game, then you probably want to avoid any long iteration cycle. Something like the values built into the editor that you can change on the fly while the game is running might be something really important for you. And of course, if you write your own custom tools, then you'll have to consider how much time you're willing to spend on those custom tools that are never going to be used in the game. And if you want to change the balance of the game and you don't want to have to push a new version every time you want to tweak a few parameters of one character, then you'll probably want to think of something that the player can download from your game server or something. For my own game Solar Rogue, I went with JSON data because as a solo developer, I really don't mind using my favorite text editor to make sweeping changes using regular expression. And if everything becomes too complex, I even don't mind whipping up a quick Python script to extract all the data I need in a format that will make sense. Which is exactly what I've been doing these last few weeks, as I've added 9 new items in my game, and I added a new type of ships, which is a trading ship who you can talk to and exchange good for energy. And at first, I just coded random values for all of these new things, but it quickly became obvious as I was playtesting that this was going to need a lot of balancing and very careful planning of all the new values I've put in the game. And to do that, I started tweaking all the values inside all of the individual JSON, but I ran into a little problem because some of the values for different items are in different JSON, and it was getting really hard to keep a map of all the items in the game in my head. So I needed some tables to expose all the important values so that I could compare everything and order it to make sure that everything made sense. So in the end, what I did is I wrote a little Python script that parsed all the JSON data from my game and extract all the information I asked it to extract. And then it just prints out a bunch of comma-separated values, and I can just copy and paste this into a Google spreadsheet, and then I can format it any way I want. I can even do formulas, I can even do some validation. I even used a couple of nice tricks. For example, I copied the same table twice, and I only modified the first one, and I used the second one to compare the current values so that I can change the color whenever I change a value, so that later I know which values I need to bring back into my JSON once I've finished tweaking all the data. I've even made myself a little dynamic table where I can put the loadout of two different ships and it's gonna tell me who's going to win. This allowed me, for example, to test my new railgun, which has the ability to pierce through shield, and to make sure that when I attack an heavily shielded enemy, it's going to win, but when it's just a regular enemy, then it's about an average weapon. Of course, I could have all done this by hand using the JSON, but it was getting a little bit tedious and it was going a little bit difficult, so I use a mix of all the previous techniques I've mentioned above to achieve my goals. Now, I admit this might not be the best or most efficient way of doing it, but actually, I'm not a game designer and I'm very new at trying to tweak these values, so I'm not exactly sure what I'm doing. But with my experience talking with other game designers and developing tools for them, I at least have a vague idea of the best way of approaching the problem. And thankfully, I believe that next week I'm going to be able to release my game on the Steam page and itch.io and on the App Store and the Google Play Store. And I'm really hoping all of you guys will download the game, try it out, and give me some feedback so that I can make it just great before it comes out of early access. In the meantime, I'm going to put a link in the description below to the Steam page of my game so that you can wishlist it because that's going to really help me in the future when I finally release my game, I think sometimes next week. So stay tuned and see you guys in my next episode. Bye!